So I will try to speak about how to use ultra products, or maybe even not ultra products in studying of stability of groups. And it's based on this work which was mentioned with Chifre, Lyubotsky, Tom, and myself. But I would like to advertise maybe some kind of use of non-standard analysis in this case, because you see there are a lot of works now in the group theory we're studying stability, and they use kind of ultra product, but always trying to avoid use some language of non-standard analysis and things. And I think that probably it sometimes gives some awkward proofs. I mean, I don't know. So the most effort try to avoid the use of non-standard analysis. Probably it because I don't know why it is. Maybe because the people who do non-standard analysis do it in some way very aggressive, in aggressive form, and that's. But not to everybody. I mean. So the general settings of use is the following: we have a group, gamma, and some kind of almost gamma morphism in some sequences of group, some sequences of group. And what we can do, this sequence of gamma, almost or some gamma, this is not gamma morphism, it's just map. So it defines map from here to the ultra, to the product, direct product of groups. And then we could factor out errors, which give me, and then this composition will be a gamma morphism, and this actually how it works. And but sometimes it is better to take before, just not instead of consider just direct product, consider ultra product. I believe that because of several things, because first the ultra product has some more intuitive meaning than just direct product, and it has some property, good properties, which we can use. Okay. This and. And maybe if we try to use some kind of non-standard analysis, then this intuitive meaning could be make more clear. So this what I planning to do to convince maybe myself more that try to do this directly. So my plan is like I'd like to define ultrafitive, then give some introduction to non-standard analysis languages with the use of ultrafilters, give the definition of stability, and try to. I'd like to mention that when I was preparing this talk, I have found a proof of using this non-standard method of some statement which. Standard use of non-standard analysis, but this statement in our paper, for example, this looks like ingenious proofs of, but actually I will show that it is trivial. Okay.
No. It will be accepted first.
Okay. So maybe I stop. Okay. So just to remind for somebody who is not with ultra filters. So this collection of subsets, which is large in some sense, so the property which that should satisfy this intersect. If I have two large subsets, then intersection is large. If some set is larger, then of course it's also large. And two of R or and its complement is large. I mean, to be an ultra filter is large or important to be important. And ultra filter is non-principal if it doesn't contain a finite set. So this is what. So particular for example, if I take a union of two sets which is in my ultra filter, then either one of the two should be in the ultra filter. And for example, if I have some property, some finite, so I have some sequences which has for each j has a finite number of possibilities, then some of this possibility is in the ultra filter. It means that some of this possibility is almost surely holds. And let me for people who knows everything this, I just ask what is the finite. I mean, of course, with these properties, it is impossible to define ultra filter on finite set. This is countable set. It exists at least. But what it means ultra filter for finite set? I think that it should be a good sampler. I mean, because you see Razborov in his proof that P is not equal in P in monotone. He used something that looks like ultra filters on finite sets. So maybe it is. So I mean, this is related with conference. So it's just not. It is not related. And okay. So using this ultra filter, we could define ultra product. So ultra product means this is sequences, but up to equivalence. Two elements are equivalent if they, two sequences are equivalent if they equals for almost all coefficients. And almost all means that it is in the ultra filter. And because of the property of ultra filter, it gives a very nice it has a very nice property. For example, if I define some operation, then the ultra product of this operation is also defined operation on ultra products. And this operation satisfies, for example, if I take fields, the results will be field. I mean, because of these properties for example, why direct product of fields is not field? Because there is zeros. I have some zeros, but some not. But here the property that if something is almost non-zero, then it is non-zero, and I could divide it. Okay. I would like to emphasize that all mathematical construction commute with taking ultrafilter. For example, what it means that ultra product of something belongs to the ultra product of subset. Actually, it means that for almost all elements it happens. So I mean, this ultra product, I don't even have to define these sequences for all elements, just for some subset which belongs to my ultra filter.
Can you characterize ultra products by some universal property? Is that possible? Is this some categorical definition?
In some sense, yes. In some sense, yes, because how works in non-standard analysis. So I'll explain later. Also, if we have some set, we could define ultra power of this set. I will denote it like this, and naturally. My set is subset of the ultra power just by diagonal inclusion. By diagonal inclusion, I can always do it. Okay, so for example, I can take real numbers, take ultra product. It is what is called non-standard model for real number, and here in this set could exist some elements which are infinitesimally small. What it means? It means that they are less than any positive. So it is positive, but less than any positive real number. So I mean, it's unwired in ultra field is rather easy. We have sequences which goes to zero actually. So this is ultra products of sequences which goes to zero. Nothing more. It's more, but and also here could be some sequences which is unbounded, which goes to infinity, and also we could define what it means bounded. Okay, so how works the non-standard analysis? So we have some object we are work with, these numbers, sets, and things like this. And using this, we construct an ultra product of all these objects. Okay? And not, yes, all this object. And this is called non-standard universe for U. And all sets of here are called internal. This is the language. This is the language of non-standard analysis, and there is a map like this. What is? And actually, there is two tools in the proof of non-standard analysis, and these tools are what is called transfer principle. It means that this is model theoretical things. It means that any statement which is true here, if and only if. I mean, this is equivalent, first order equivalent. And for example, if I have, in ordinary analysis, I have this statement. It states that any subset, if it is bounded, then it has exact bound. Okay. Then by transfer principle, I could derive this this statement that any subset but which is internal. So to unwind it is any subset which is ultra product of something has supremum. Has supremum like this. And for example this set has no supremum. I mean this all but the problem that this is not internal. This is not constructed by ultra product, and informally it means that in definition I use these things. This is not ordinary mathematical things. It gives that x is infinitesimally small. I mean it is not in the language of the in this language of U. So what? Internal, okay. Internal is that it is ultra product of something.
Of another set? Of a list of sets?
Of a list of sets. Mm-hmm. Yes, of a list of sets, of a list of elements. This is an ultra product. Okay? But if I have some mathematical expression, mm-hmm. Yes, because taking ultra product commute with this method, so it means that what I construct normally from internal set should be internal set. This main feature of this, but this is not internal. This is external because I use here this that it is less than something and here in definition of this. I use this, but this set is not ultra product. In my I have universe and I have this non-standard. Here my analog of this is this, not this. For definition of this, I use this, so this is not internal, no problem, and it has no supremum because okay, it is less than any. It's easy to see that it is. We have a contradiction. So you see, the definition is use this R, which is not internal. Okay. And the other important feature, which is used, this what is called saturation. And saturation means if I have, in this context, if I have a countable collection of internal set such that any finite subcollection has non-empty intersection, then this whole collection it has non-empty intersection. So this is what is. For example, I could proof using this, I could prove that that countable sets of infinitesimals exist bound, which is itself infinitesimal. Let me just try to prove it because it's actually reveal how How one can use non-standard analysis? It is exactly. So I have a countable set, which is every element is infinitesimal. I could define. These sets intervals from, for example, g to 1g. Okay, this I consider as a. So you could always think that it is ultra product of. So this is itself ultra product, and this is ultra product of intervals which define it. This and this set. Is subset of this set, and easily this satisfy finite intersection property, because here there is some, if I intersect, here there is some, if I intersect finite number, then there is some bound, which is not infinitesimal, so it is not, and this is always infinitesimal, so it is always, there is something here. So by property, by saturation, this intersection is non-empty, and also it is clear that this intersection contains only infinitesimals, and they are more than any of this, yes, because of definition, what I do. So this how actually. Yes. So.
What do we understand about the order relation between infinitesimal? It's like the
order. They order it. They, of course, well ordered. I mean, for each two, one is less. And but I don't know what it means actually too much. But I believe that any order of countable sets I could organize by infinitesimals. So it is. Okay. So and now after this short course, I try to come to the stability of groups. So this is related well with previous talk. So we have a finitely presented group, and we have a collection of groups with metric. And metric is supposed to be b-invariant, so this the shift. So as example, could be permutation group, symmetric group with this Hamming distance, which was discussed in previous talk. Also, it could be unitary group with distance like this with some norm. Okay, the norm I could choose some norm which I like. And stability will depend on the choice of the norm. Okay. So now, if I have I have the group, finitely presented group. This is my generator. This is my relators, and have a groups with metric. So I could define, if I have a map from this is just map from a finite set to a group, then this of course trivially define a gamma morphism from a free group generated by this set to this group. Okay, and then I define some quantity. The distance between these two is just maximum, because this set is finite, so this is just maximum between these distances. What is defect? Defect is measure how far this phi from B actual gamma morphism, because this phi define this gamma morphism, so I could define it on relators. On relators on my group, normally it is not one, so it is not a gamma morphism, and this distance is actually how far it from being gamma morphism. So this is defect. Also, I could define the distance from phi from gamma morphism. So it is the distance from the set. Yes, I take the distance from phi and f, where f is gamma morphism, and take all possibilities. So this is distance from gamma morphism. Well, what? I just fixed one of them. No, I just fixed one of them. Then I will consider the sequence.
So far,
I didn't. So you have
yes.
You have X.
Set of generators of a group. Set of generators of the group. And because this is generator, I measure my distance only on the set of generator. And measure defect only on. So it is not good. It is not good because it depends on gamma. Yes, not on X. I measure the defect just for relators. And also I could define these things. It looks like how far from actual gamma morphism could be phi if its defect is small. Yes, if its defect is small. And on this language, I just introduced this. On this language, the stability is very easy. The stability means that this has a limit. Its limit is zero when epsilon approach to zero.
D of epsilon?
No. Defect of phi. Okay. Defect of so for all phis whose defect is less than. So actually, to be this, I could define overall j. So I mean, overall my group's element. This is fixed, but this fixed as a set. So I take phi is for any j. So this is not well defined. I mean, phi is any possibility that is here.
I'm not sure. How do you think of a phi with small defect? It's like close to one. What does it mean?
Small defect is close to actual gamma morphism. One is unity in the group. One is the unity in my group. So this.
I can understand what is the misunderstanding. Mm-hmm. Any map phi of psi define homomorphism from the free group. Right? From the free group, there are no obstructions. Now, if the relations are satisfied completely, then this homomorphism splits factor through gamma, because gamma is simply the free group divided by the normal sum generated by R. So the defect measures to what extent you are potentially close to be homomorphism.
Okay, I have no clue why what's written there is related to what you said, but...
You want the relations to go to one, but if they don't go to one, maybe they're close to one.
Yes.
Yeah. All right, now
we get it. Yes, it is the same. This is set of equation. Yes. This is the same, but just another notation and language. And I just write this to avoid this statement for any epsilon exists delta, blah, blah, blah. This looks like more Okay. Now, I would like to come from here to the non-standard version of this. So just what I do, I just x is x, ultra product of finite set is the finite set with the same cardinality, and instead of this, I consider ultra products. Of
let me just check something. Mm-hmm. Actually, the whole slide could make perfect sense if there was only a single group.
Yes.
So there is actually a double, with the soup, there is a double.
Yes. I understand that. Yes, that here phi is any function from to any. Yes. So up to here, it seems to be could be fixed, no problem, because phi is fixed. But here is overall. Mm-hmm. Okay. So now let come to the non-standard version. It means that now I have a map from this finite set to this ultra product, and all this definition comes through ultra product. So I could consider that everything is a sequences, but factored by this relation. So then this definition looks more. I mean, it's very 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 easy to read. Group is stable if the defect is infinitesimal. Imply that the distance from actual gamomorphism is infinitesimal. I don't know if we gain a lot, but let me define in this group define these two things. So I consider. Take epsilon and consider these subgroups here, such that the distance, even divided by epsilon could be infinitesimal, even divided by epsilon is still bounded, and this is that distance divided by epsilon is more than bounded, is infinitesimal. So these two sets, it is not difficult to show that if distance is B invariant, then action of group is not change the distance. So this is normal subgroup. These are normal subgroup. These are normal subgroup of this J. Yes, it is a kind of version of O and little. So this is little O and this is O. It is the same somehow. But what is good that this is normal subgroup of J. So I could.
By DG, you mean the distance from G to the identity?
Yes. Sorry. Yes, here should be an identity. Yes. The distance from G to identity. Then what I can show this that this phi if defect is small, then it defines gamomorphism from here to even one. I hear this epsilon could be one. So if I just from J take equivalence for infinitesimal small, then I take an actual gamomorphism. So the question what it means that this Elmos gamomorphism is close to to exact dimorphism. So it means the following. I have my group gamma. I have Elmos gamma morphism, which is gamma morphism to this set, A1 of infinitesimals. And to be that it is close to actual gamma morphism, it means that I could lift it to J such that this diagram commute. So and actually, because here is not, so I don't need to leave all this to here. I mean, if I consider this image of gamma here, and this is full pre-image of this by this arrow, then the lift is from here to here. So I'd like to say that then we have the following things, that this is close to actual gamma morphism if and only if this exact sequence is split. So it means that I could from here exist a map to here, which is gamma morphism. So this is exactly splitting things.
That's an if and only if statement, right?
Yes. Here there is some subtlety, because you see this construction, what I do is not external. This is internal construction, but there is no problem here, because I have to define this only on set of generators. A set of generators is finite, and any finite set is in is internal. So I mean, just by this things is there is no problem with this. It is not clear if we could win something from here, but let me go further. And
could you go back to the last slide?
Okay.
You said something about what is that exact sequence?
E1 is this is normal subgroup of I have this. This is this from here to here is the map which quotient by E1. So, and this is just full pre-image of this. So this. So, for example, if I could prove that my group satisfies this group, why we don't gain a lot? Because it is not, the structure of this group is rather difficult. So, but if I could prove that my group, I could explain what it means, at least intuitively, what kind of groups it is. But if I prove that any extension by this is split, then it actually will mean that my group is stable. But I am not sure that it is one and only one. It's only. You see, because probably not all extension comes from this situation, so it is not clear that the statement if and only if. But yes, it's some kind of, if I have this kind of things, I could try to make extension by this, but okay. We are not gaining a lot because of this group, but still, I don't know, maybe it is possible to. Okay. What I like to define is this defect diminishing, and I would like to define it only using non-standard language, and it means that if I will say that my Elmos representation possess the defect diminishing, if I could found another Elmos representation such that it has essentially beta defect.
Essentially, so even divided by this, and but not so far from original one. This is bounded, and this is
okay. And now just like this, what it means, defect diminishing. Defect diminishing means that in this diagram, this I divide by set which is bounded with respect to defect, to my defect, and I could lift it to the gamma morphism which is bounded with respect to beta. This is infinitesimal with respect to defect. So defect diminishing, actually this is if and only if. Phi satisfy effect diminishing if and only if exist these things. So, but it means now splitting of this diagram, but now I have this group. And this group is often much better. For example, it could be abelian. And if it is abelian, then what I have? I have actually to show that any extension is split, I just need to, I'm now in cohomology theory, in H2. So that's why I appear in H2 in this situation. Okay.
Why would it be abelian?
I probably will explain if I will have time. But not for all choices. It is not always. It depends on the exact norm I choose. Okay.
But it's like the tangent space to a manifold.
Yes. The norm should be good. I mean, okay. Yes. If this is Lie algebra, product, for example, of unitary groups, then this is actually Lie algebra. But of course, if the norm is good, if I take a bad norm, it will not Lie algebra. Yes. It's. Okay. So, but what I'd like, and what it was, so far, for example, suppose that we could prove that any Elmos representation possesses defect diminishing. Could it imply that group is stable? Because it should be like this. So we have to prove that if any Elmos representation possess effect definition, then gamma is stable. What I am going to prove, and all this before, just to give a trivial proof of this fact, and that struggle to this, but it's actually almost trivial. Okay, so far we have this statement. Yes, suppose that the group any Elmos representation possesses this. Okay, satisfy this condition. Okay. What is the problem here is that it just says that it is bounded, but I have no, it looks like that I have no bound. I don't know bound, actually. Yes, but because this is a non-standard analysis statement, I actually from here could give. So my okay. So first of all, I just this change to 1/2. Of course, it is true. Yes, because if it is infinitesimal, it is less than 1/2. I mean, it's trivial. Okay. Now, What I do, what it says? It says that if it is almost zero, then it is bounded. But actually, from here is true the following statement. Exist epsilon and exist m, such that if this less than epsilon, then this less than m. Why? As an epsilon, I could take any infinitesimal, because it says this, so any infinitesimal works. And here, any unbounded real number works. I mean, I now working in, I'm choosing my epsilon and m in R star, I'm working, and this statement is internal. I mean, the problem with this statement is that it is external, and who knows what we can do, but this statement is internal, so it means that this statement is true in initial settings, if phi is actually not ultra product, but gamma morphism from phi to my GI. And using this, I just construct the sequence, I mean, so this is a statement, internal statement, and from this I just construct Cauchy sequence, which converge to a gamma morphism, that's all. So I mean, the statement which we were trying to prove, because we are not saw it in this way. We're trying to work with ultra product, and it is not, I mean, too much quantifiers yes, to work with. And here, of course, it looks very formal. I mean, it's just some manipulation. But yes, here there is specialist on model theory, but it's okay. Okay, yes, it's
yeah,
this proof.
Means that you start with phi. The bounded statement says that it's very close to psi because.
What? This
upstairs, yeah, yeah.
This bounded it close with respect to defect.
Yeah,
yes.
And then you change it to psi, but now you know from the first part that now the defect is even smaller with respect to the defect of psi. So moving from phi to psi, you made good progress.
Yes,
and then
yes.
You make more and more progress.
Without
yes, but.
And
yes, so this this and now it's rather easy. Yes, I just start with phi and construct phi j which with defect less than epsilon, and then which is exist from here, and then just take away j such that defect of this is less than epsilon to the j, and then the distance from phi j and phi j plus one will be less than which give me this will be less than m epsilon to the j. So I from here I construct Cauchy sequences which converge to actual gamma morphism. That's because defect is convergent. That's all. So actually. Okay. So how time I have? Okay. Then I stop here because it is.